Hey gamers, this is Liz Davidson from Beyond Solitaire, and I'm here to show you how to play Role Player, a game designed by Keith Matejka and published by Thunderworks Games. In Role Player, you're playing as a fantasy character who's about to go on an adventure, but hasn't yet. And so this is a game about getting the best possible starting stats and starting armor in order to get the highest score at the end of the game. For this game, we'll be playing as a dwarf, and we're gonna be getting her set up and choosing her class, her backstory, her alignment, and then figuring out how to get her set up for a great adventure. So the first thing our dwarven friend is gonna need is a class. So we're gonna reach into the dice bag and pull out a random die, and its color is gonna be the class that we'll be playing this game. Okay, so we've drawn a black die, and that is gonna tell us which class card to look at so we can choose our starting class. So now we have a couple of choices. So here's the card that matches the black die. One side says Thief, and we would have the special ability of Shrewd. When placing a gold die on your character sheet, you can gain 4 gold instead of 2. And these are the stats that we'd be aiming for by the end of the game. Our other option is a Rogue. So when using a skill card, you do not have to move your alignment marker. Ooh, that's pretty good, actually. This one has a higher emphasis on dexterity than the other. So this is like a more charismatic, intelligent character. This one is a little bit more dexterous and has some balance across the board. Interesting. Okay, so when picking this, the thing I'm gonna be noticing the most is actually this charisma stat. So to be a rogue, I only need 15 to 16 charisma in the game. To be a successful thief, I need 17. And that is just not a bill I think that we can fit. Because as a dwarf, I have a +2 to constitution. So if we had a higher constitution need, that would be great. But my charisma is actually -2. I don't think there's any way, even with 6, 12, 18 dice pips showing, that I would be able to actually hit the charisma goal. So no matter what, we're gonna pick the rogue class. So we're gonna be a dwarven rogue. Hey, just like my Dragon Age character. So before we fully get going, I wanna just kind of take you on a tour of my complete character card right now so you can get a sense of why I'm doing the things that I'm doing in the game. So my class is telling me what total of dice pips I need to hit in order to score certain numbers of victory points. So we know that for strength, I need to have 16 or 17, not 15, not 18, in order to get 2 victory points for this row. For dexterity, I need to hit 18 on the nose. For constitution, I need to get 14 to 15. For intelligence and wisdom, I just need 14 plus, so it can be any value over 14. And then for charisma, I need to really hit between 15 and 16 for those victory points. And there are little special things about my class that make this easier or harder, depending. I mean, about my race. So my constitution as a dwarf, it gets a +2 modifier. And then my charisma is gonna get a -2. So I need to be thinking about those modifiers as I choose to place dice throughout the game. Each of these rows also has a special action. So every time I place a die in these rows during gameplay, after the initial dice placement setup stuff, I can actually perform the action on that row. So if I put a die here in the strength row, I can actually flip a die to its opposite face. So a 1 would become a 6, a 2 could become a 5, or vice versa if I need to make a smaller value. Dexterity allows you to change the location of any 2 dice that you've placed. So you can't put a die in an empty spot, but if I had, you know, a die here and a die here, I don't know, I could actually use a dexterity action to flip them and just switch them with each other. Constitution allows you to move a die value up or down, but dice don't loop. So you can't take a 1 and turn it into a 6 or a 6 and turn it into a 1. That's not allowed in the game. Intelligence is cool because it lets you take a die that you don't particularly like and re-roll it. And if you don't like the re-roll, you're allowed to keep the original value. So either way, it's worth a shot. Wisdom allows you to move your attribute marker. So we are going to talk about that a little more in just a second, but basically it lets me manipulate this card over here. And then charisma gives you a special token that lets you get a discount on your next market purchase, which is pretty cool because everyone knows that people give money to people who have charisma. So that's basically how this card will work. We also know that when using a skill card, I don't have to move my alignment marker. So let's talk about what that means. Most skill cards are going to come with an alignment marker requirement. For example, this one that says search. All right, see how this has a little arrow right here pointing to the left? That means that you need to be able to move your alignment marker in this direction in order to use this skill. So skills move your alignment around, but you don't necessarily want your alignment to move around too much, or at least not in a way that you can't control, because you score based on where it is at the end of the game. So for me, I'm a lunatic, of course, where game meets reality. So I'm chaotic and I'm evil. So if I can make my alignment marker end here or here, I'm gonna get one victory point at the end of the game, but if I can get it down into this bottom right corner, I'm gonna get a +3. So I'm gonna be having to think about that as I go. So skills that make me seem like a goody two-shoes, I'm gonna have to mitigate those if I choose to buy some. So the other thing that's cool, however, about being a rogue is that I don't have to move my alignment marker at all. So I can just use my wisdom to get my marker where I want it, and then just use whatever skills I want because I don't have to move my alignment marker. That's a pretty cool bonus. So now that you know how those work, let me also explain my backstory. So I'm a brawler, but what's really important is that I need to make sure that I'm placing dice in ways that match these colors if I want to get some of the bonus points on this card. If I match one, I get if I match 2 to 3 of these dice colors, I get 1 point. If I get 4 to 5, that is 3 points. If I get all 6, that's a whopping 6 points. So I'm gonna want a green die here. I'm gonna want a red die here. Blue, purple, black, white. So these are all things that you can think about and manipulate as you go through the game to make sure that your score is closer to what you want it to be. And we'll also see how some cards can help us get extra victory points as well. Now we can finish character setup. And all we need to do at this point is roll 6 dice, so it's like starter dice, and place them in our character sheet. So I've pulled 6 dice. Let's give them a roll. Okay, that's actually not a bad starting roll at all. All right, so things aren't looking too bad for my dwarf as we get started. We have a pretty decent starting roll, and now we're gonna apportion some dice. The first thing we're going to do is I'm actually going to go ahead and take this white die and place it right here in the charisma row. You would think that I already have a disadvantage in charisma and this one is kind of low, but I'm going to show you a way that we can manipulate it during the game. Next thing I'm going to do is we need to have pretty high strength and dexterity. So I'm just going to go ahead and put 6s in those rows. That seems like a pretty good thing to do. All right, so next, we are going to, I think I'm gonna give myself a 5 for constitution, and then for intellect and wisdom, we're just gonna like put these here and hope for the best. I could do something like try to put this green up here instead and work on my backstory, but as you're gonna see, each of these rows offers us some actions that we can do when we place dice there, and I wanna maximize the strength actions that I'm going to be able to take. I'm gonna put my alignment marker here, right in the middle, so I can work on it throughout the game. And I'm also going to take some starting gold. So these gold dice actually worked out great because all players start with 5 gold. So we get a starting total of 5, but I get to take 2 additional gold per gold die, which means that I'm starting with 9 gold instead of 5. That's very good news for me, as you're going to see once we start getting exciting market cards to purchase. Now that our dwarf is ready for battle, we're ready to set up the market deck. One of the main distinguishing factors between types of cards in the market deck is the number of dots they have, and these are key for setup. So these are more advanced and more expensive cards, so we're going to shuffle them real quick and put them on the bottom of the deck. We'll get to them partway through the game. Then we'll take the cards with 1 dot on them, shuffle those together, and put them on top of the market deck. And that is how you set up the market deck for Roleplayer. When you're setting up your market deck, you should remove the Diplomacy card. This is a card that requires you to interact with other players, so it's not needed in the solo game. To get set up to play Roleplayer, you need to set up an initiative track and the actual market row. The initiative track, as you're going to see, is where we're going to put dice that we have the option of drafting. And then the market deck is going to be up here. And in a single player game, you lay out 3 cards on the market row. We're also going to have a discard pile, and I'm going to put a trash pile up here because in the solo version of the game, some cards can be removed from the game completely. But for now, here is our starting setup. So now we're ready to start playing. And the way this is going to work is that we are going to have an enemy die that we roll, and it will remove cards from the market depending on how we choose to draft dice from the initiative track. But for now, the first thing we're going to do is just pick three dice from the bag and roll them. All right, I think we are ready to play our first round of role player. The first phase is going to be the roll phase. So we're going to draft three dice from the bag. We got a black, a blue, and a white die. We're going to roll them. Okay, that wasn't a bad roll. So now what we're going to do is we're going to put them in ascending order on these cards. So the black three will go here, the blue five will go here, and the white six will go here. What happens next is going to depend on the die that we choose. I'm interested in this blue die here because it will help fulfill my backstory and it'll keep my constitution score nice and high. I'm not sure I want to take a constitution action yet though, so I need to maybe think about that. You know what? We're going to go for it. So the thing that happens next depends on which of the dice in this initiative track we take. I'm going to grab the one in spot two, and I'm going to show you what happens as a result of that. So we're going to take this die. We're going to place it here. And of course, we get this gold. And now I get to take a constitution action, which means that I get to move one of my stats here up or down. I think what I'm going to go ahead and do is my intelligence isn't looking so hot. I want to do something with this die, so I'm not going to move that. So let's just give it a little bump. So after you place your die, you get to take the action associated with that row, which I just did. And that's my die placement. The next phase is going to be the market phase, but I don't get to go first in the market because I took the second die and not the first in this row. That means that we're going to roll this gold enemy die, and we're going to see if any of the cards get removed from the market. Because I took the two, if I roll a four, a five, or a six, nothing happens. If I roll a one, a two, or a three, the corresponding card is going to get trashed from the game, and I won't be able to buy it. So let's see what we roll. Okay, so we rolled a two. That means the heavy crossbow is gone. It is in the trash pile, and we can no longer access it. However, now it's my turn to buy something. Sadly, I'd actually really like to have either of these cards, but I'm going to go ahead, see how my wisdom score is kind of crappy. We're going to go ahead and buy foolish so that we can benefit from that. So we're going to pay two for this foolish card, which says, gain two victory points if either your intelligence or wisdom attribute score is eight or less. So we can just go ahead and be an idiot because we're going to score for that at the end of the game. The other thing about this little attribute card is see the arrow up by the two, the one that's pointing to the right? That is actually going to adjust our alignment when we take this card. Fortunately for us, it's adjusting our alignment in a direction that we want. But you need to be careful when you buy these characteristic or trait cards because they do affect your alignment and your alignment affects your score. So we've gone ahead and taken this foolish card, perhaps foolishly, ha ha ha. And now our alignment's going to move. So it's going to move one to the right. So for us, because we're a lunatic and it's moving us towards the chaotic end of the spectrum, that's actually good. So moving one to the right is good for my character because we're moving closer to our ideal alignment, which would also have us move a little bit more in the evil direction. Now what's going to happen is cleanup. These dice go back in the bag to potentially be drawn another time. The leftmost, in this case I'm going to say topmost, card in the market goes into the discard pile. If there were any other market cards left in this row, those would all go to the trash and they would no longer be available at all in this game. There is a card somewhere in the market that lets you mess with the discard pile. We'll see if it comes up. But if you don't get it and it doesn't, you know, and you have a bunch of cards that are kind of left in the market row, at least one of them is going to go to the trash in this game. You can't just kind of keep everything available. So now we're just going to move this gold die out of the way. That stays out of the bag because it's the enemy die. And we're going to reset the market row. So you got a quarterstaff, some chain leggings, and ooh, some leather boots. This is exciting, so hopefully we'll see if we can get some of those. You also replenish the gold on this market card, or the initiative card, and we'll draw three more dice and see what we get. So this time we got a red, a blue, and a green. So let's roll them and see what we get. All right, so we have a blue 3, a red 4, and a green 5. So what I'm gonna do this time actually is I'm gonna go ahead and take the third die in the initiative track, partially to show you what it does, and partially because I'd really like to put this green 3 right here. So I put it in the strength row. Note that I'm working pretty nicely my brawler backstory right now, which is one of the reasons I decided to grab that. I can also take a strength action, which is to flip one die to its opposite face. So wisdom I no longer really care about, but charisma I'd like to bump. So we're just gonna flip that 1 to a 6, and things are already looking a little bit better on the charisma front. I've also taken a risk, however, which is that I'd really like to buy this card, but if I roll the wrong number on my golden enemy die, I'm not gonna get it. So hopefully everything works out for us in terms of luck. Because I picked a 3 this time, so when you roll a 2, a 4 or 5 or a 6 means that nothing happens to the market row. The 3 guarantees something will be lost. So if I roll a 1 or a 2, we lose the quarterstaff. If I roll a 3 or a 4, we lose the chain leggings. And if I roll a 5 or a 6, we're gonna lose our leather boots. So let's see what happens to us. All right, so we rolled a 1. Whew, the quarterstaff is gonna get trashed. Now I get to make a purchase. So I'm gonna go ahead and spend 3 gold to pick up these leather boots. And the thing that's particularly good about leather boots for me is that if you have a purple or a black class, then you will get an extra point for your set at the end of the game. So I already got 1 and then 2 for my class points off of these leather boots. The more leather we can get, the better. Let's keep that in context. Now it's time for cleanup. So these dice are gonna go back in the bag. And because this is the only card left in the market row, it's leftmost card, this one will go in the discard pile and we'll reset the market. So we've pulled some fresh dice. Now we have red and yellow and green. So let's see what we get. Hopefully good gold number. Not wonderful. Okay, so you have 1, 2, and 4. So what I'd actually like to do is I'm not particularly interested in any of these market cards right now. I think that I would like to get some money. So my interest is in taking this gold die with the extra gold, because you get 2 gold for every gold die you place, plus I would get the 1 that's on this initiative card. So that would make some money for me, and I don't really want any of these cards on the market row this turn for my goals, so I'm going to show you what happens if you discard a card from the market on the market turn, so you can see how that works. Since I've decided that I'm not going to be very wise, I'm going to go ahead and grab this die. I'm going to put it here in the wisdom track because, you know, Lord knows I don't want a high wisdom total now with my foolish card. I want my wisdom to be 8 or less. So I can move my wisdom in one direction, my alignment down, because it's my wisdom action. So I'm gonna move it here. Not a bad choice. And now my alignment's where I want it for the moment. And I have placed this gold die. So I'm gonna get this gold and I'm gonna get 2 more for placing a gold die. Now it's gonna be the enemy turn. So we're gonna roll and see if we lose anything. So the enemy die rolled a 3. That means that dedicated is gonna go to the trash. And I don't particularly wanna buy either of these cards. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take this intimidate card. I'm gonna put it in the discard pile. And when you discard a card from the market row, you gain another 2 gold. So I've made a total of 5 gold this turn just from picking a gold die and discarding a card from the market, which is pretty good. And then since this is the leftmost card in the row, for cleanup, this goes in discard, and these dice go back to the bag. So now I've reset the market. I'm excited about these leather gloves, so it's a good thing I got some money last turn. Now I'm drafting some dice. All right, so we'll move this one out of the way. Now I have a black, a red, and a white. We'll see what we roll. Oh, wow, okay. So we have a 1, a 2, and this black 6. So that black 6 has a great value on it, which is very exciting for me. But the other thing that's important about it is that it is my character's class color, which means that I would get an extra point for it at the end of the game. So I think that I really, really would like to take that die. So let's figure out where we'd like to put it. even though I don't want to take a dexterity action, I think I'm going to take this die. I'm going to put it right here. I do need a straight on 18 to get my full dexterity points, and that 6 is going to be really helpful. So we're just going to grab it and put it there. And then we are going to roll for the enemy die. I really, really hope we don't roll a 1 or a 2. That'd be extremely unfortunate. Come on. A 6. Awesome. Okay, so the longsword does disappear, which is a shame, to the trash. However, I get to buy these leather gloves, which matters quite a bit to me. So I'm going to pay 3 for those. Grab that. I now have 2 sets of pieces in my leather armor set. And this one, because it's the last card left, is going to go to the discard pile. All right, so we have reset the market row and rolled ourselves some dice. So this time we have a blue 2, a purple 3, and a blue 4. I'm not terribly interested in any of those at the moment. I do know that I really want to buy this cunning card. That is particularly important for me. So let's think about what the best strategy is going to be here. All right, I think what I'm going to do is I want to make sure I can buy this cunning card. I really like it. So I'm going to go ahead and put this 2 here in charisma. By taking the first die, I get first crack at the market. So I'm going to go ahead and grab that and hope that I can use a strength action to flip it later to get my charisma up a little bit. And then we will go from there. Because for the wisdom row, I'm waiting on a black die. I should build out on my intelligence, but I need my intelligence to be 14 plus. And that 2 is not really getting me there. I'm just trying to like make the best choices to fill this chart out. So I took that die. Now I'm going to go ahead and buy cunning, because it gives you 1 star of victory point for each skill card that you have. So to me, that's pretty exciting, because as a rogue, when I'm using a skill card, I don't actually have to move my alignment marker. So I can just take as many skills as I want and see if any of them are useful later. It doesn't actually hurt me in any way. And now I can just get a victory point for every random one that I buy. So I'm going to go ahead and grab cunning. Notice, however, that it pushes my alignment 1 to the left. So my alignment was in the sweet spot, but by purchasing this card, it's going to move 1 to the left. Fortunately, I'm going to have another wisdom action to move it back. And I also have the option of getting a skill that will move my alignment in the direction that I want. So now there are 2 cards left in the market row. The leftmost one, which I've decided is the topmost, is going to go here in the discard pile. Honest is going to move straight to the trash. All right, so we pulled some new cards from the market row, including some skills, which could be pretty exciting. And we also have some fresh dice, a red, a green, and a black. So let's see what we roll. Okay, so we have a red 2, a black 3, and a green 6. Interesting. Okay, I think what I'm going to go ahead and do, actually, is to make sure I don't run out of money, and also to get my alignment back where I want, I'm going to go ahead and grab this black 3. I'm going to use it to finish off my wisdom row. So I'm going to take this gold, because I took that die. I also finished this row, which means that I get 1 more gold. And the good thing about a wisdom, about the this black 3 is that my wisdom row is complete and it's going to be under 8. So I'm going to get the victory points that I want at the end. I can also take the wisdom action, which is to move my alignment back to this lovely 3. So now that I've taken the second card in the row, we're going to roll the enemy die and see which, if any, card they take from the market. Okay, so they rolled a 1. That means that they're going to take climb, which is sad because it was the cheapest one. So that goes to the trash. I am going to go ahead and pay 3 in order to pull this sleight of hand skill card so that I can score off of it later in the game. This obnoxious card is going to go to the discard and we'll clean up for yet another round. All right, so now I have a red, a gold, and a white die. We'll replace this. We've reset the market cards already and let's roll. Oh, wow. Okay, so I can choose to set, when there's 2 dice of the same value, I can choose where they go on the initiative track. And then we have this red 6. Oh, that's a tough choice. Because I would really love to take this gold die and get some money. But this 6 is going to complete my dexterity row and fulfill part of my backstory. I think I have to take it. I'm absolutely taking this red six. Fortunately, I don't actually want any of the cards in the market row. I just could have made more money, but that's okay. So do I want to take a dexterity action, which will allow me to switch to dice? No, I don't want to do that. Okay, it's a waste of dexterity actions, but that's okay. So this card is going to disappear from, wait, no, it's 1, 2, 3, 4. This one's going to disappear into the trash. I'm going to go ahead and discard Reckless in exchange for 2 gold. And then this one is the last card in the market. We'll just go into discard. We'll reset and go again. Chain Helm, Loyal, Pickpocket. I might want to pick up Pickpocket just because it's a skill. All right, so we pulled 3 more dice, a gold, which is good, 2 blues, which is boring. And let's see what we get. Okay, so we got a 4 and we have 2 fives. I'm gonna go ahead and put the fives like this so that if I take one, I can get more money. Okay, here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna start building up my intelligence. I'm gonna take this die and this gold and 2 more gold because I just placed a gold die. Yes. And I'm gonna take an intelligence action. So for an intelligence action, I can re-roll any die on here and see if I get a higher value. I can keep the old one if I want. So I'm gonna take this blue and re-roll it and see if I get something higher down here on this charisma row, which I did. So I'm absolutely gonna keep that 4 because I'm aiming for 15 to 16 on charisma, which means that I'm gonna need to get up high enough to handle that -2 and still be in the 15-16 range, which means I need to get at least a 17. So now I'm at 10. I can probably get a high die here if I'm lucky and use a constitution action or something to bump that up 1. All right, so let's roll this die and see if the market's gonna take anything from me. Hopefully not. Hopefully we don't roll a 3. Ah, we rolled a 3. All right, so I did not get this pickpocket. That's a shame because it would have scored me just a free point for being a skill. I don't really want to go into the business of collecting chain armor because I don't think I'm going to get enough to score big off of it. I'm going to go ahead and discard it for 2 gold. You can actually collect as much armor as you want, so this may have not been an optimal strategy, but we're just going to do what we do. And then this is going to go into discard. All right, so we're all set up for this next turn. We got 3 fresh dice. Let's see what we roll. Wow. Okay, so we got a 5, a 5, and a 6. What are we gonna do with this? I think what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take this black 5 and I'm gonna go ahead and put it on the strength row. It'd be nice to be able to use that strength action to flip something, but it is not to be. But I do get this gold and I'm gonna get an extra victory point at the end for placing a black die. So let's see what the gold die takes off the market and then decide if we want to buy anything. All right, so it didn't actually because it rolled a 6 on a 4, a 5, and a 6. If you've taken the second die, nothing happens. So let's see, do I want any of these items? Also, by the way, I should take a coin for finishing my strength row. So that's a good thing. So I think what I'm gonna do is I'm not gonna buy this Mystic Cloak because I wanna complete my leather collection. I'm not sure which cards are gonna come up, but I'm hoping it'll be more leather and I wanna be able to buy it. I'm gonna go ahead and just ditch Courageous, which will give me 2 gold. Mystic Cloak will also go to discard and Longbow will go to the trash. And then we will, oop, see, there's that leather pauldron. All right, just grab 3 dice. Hopefully this purple will roll high. Wow, actually did. Okay, so let's do 5, and then because I can choose, we're gonna go 6, 6. And I'm gonna grab this 6 right here and pop it right there on intelligence and take that piece of gold. So now I can re-roll a die if I so choose. Is there anything that I would like to re-roll? It's an interesting question. I guess I can re-roll this and just kind of see if I get higher. I can always keep the 4 if I want. So let's just try it and see what happens. All right, so that was just a 3. I think we're gonna roll with the 4. Okay, so now we're gonna roll this gold die. Hopefully my leather pauldron is not taken from me. Okay, a 6. So nothing happens. We are going to roll, we're gonna pay 4 to pick up this leather pauldron. Yay, so that's 3 out of 4 pieces of leather. Hopefully this continues to work out. And then now this is going to go to discard. This is going to go to the trash. And then we'll draw some more cards. Man, I would really like to be able to buy some skills because I know I get free points for that. But I mean, the leather is worth a lot more. We'll reset. All right, so this time we pulled a red, a white, and a black. Move this out of the way. Let's see what we roll. Okay. So, what order do I want these in? So I get to choose maybe that, or maybe I'll put the black here and not take any risks. I know I want to take this die. Let's just see if there's a good place for me to put it. Actually, there is. This is perfect. I can take this black die and use it to complete my constitution row because this adds up to 12, but I get a plus 2 modifier, which puts me right at 14. That's actually perfect. So it's definitely what I want to do. And then I am going to pay for these leather greaves, which gives me a complete set of leather. How exciting. This goes to the discard. This goes to the trash. New market cards. Ooh, mystic robes. And move silently. An expensive skill, but a skill. All right, and then this stays here. All right, so we'll draw 3 more dice. This is gonna be our last turn, our very last one. So let's see what we get. Oh, and because I completed my constitution row, I absolutely get to take my constitution action. So this is gonna go up to a 5. That is what I've decided, because I need to get to 15 to 16 in the charisma with a minus 2. So going into this next turn, I'm gonna need, I have 11. I don't know if there's anything I can do to make this work. So we got some new dice. Let's see what we roll. Oh, wow. Okay. So you have a 2, a 5, and a 6. I'm 100% grabbing this 6. And we are putting it here because 12, 17 minus 2 is 15, which completes this row the way we need it to. It's a miracle. Yes. And then let's see if we can buy anything more off the market, such as perhaps move silently. So that was 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is gone, but I do have an opportunity to purchase this skill. So I'm absolutely going to do that. I still have 3 gold left, so not too bad. I ended up super broke this game. Okay, so I had taken this skill. I'm gonna put it over here, and that is a complete game of role player. I'm gonna show you how to calculate your scores, and then also because I didn't actually use a skill this game, weirdly, that's never happened before, I will show you how they're used so that you know how to do it in your game. Since we didn't get to it in the actual game, I just wanna give you all a quick walkthrough of some skills. So I've given myself a couple of skills that we can just practice with on this character card, and I just want you to see how they work. So when you use a skill, let's say for example that I wanted a different color die, like that my backstory needed something different, I could basically exhaust this search card to search the dice bag and exchange one die in your character sheet with a new die of the same face value. So for example, if I wanted this purple die to be a green die, I could exhaust this card, search the dice bag, or let's say that I want it to be gold. I'll search the dice bag and I can actually put a gold die right here in place of the purple one. So the value stays the same, but you can change the color. So this is a good card to have if you're not pulling the dice that you want. However, using a skill has consequences because you have to move your alignment in accordance with the direction of the arrow on the card. So in this case, I would have had to move my alignment 1 to the left, more towards the lawful side, and then try to get it back to scoring range for myself. The other thing that's interesting about skills is that you can use as many of as you want per turn. So I could have used search, and I could use acrobatics, and I could decide that I wanted to make this die worth 1 less, and this one more, if that was what I chose to do, because that's the skill. I would move my alignment marker up 1, because that's what the card specifies. So you can use as many skills as you want in a turn. They can all pretty much be used right away. Even not necessarily on your own turn in a multiplayer game. However, you can only refresh 1 skill per turn. So for the next turn, I could only choose 1 of these to ready and use again. The other thing to know about skills is that if you can't move your alignment marker in the direction required, so for example, if my alignment marker were here at the edge and I wanted to use my search, I couldn't because I can't move my alignment marker any further to the left. So that is how skills work. You can use as many as you want, whenever you want, but you can only refresh one per turn, and you have to be able to move your alignment marker to make the skill happen. This rogue special power was when using a skill card, you don't have to move your alignment marker, which would have been really cool if that had been more of a part of our strategy in the game that I played. All right, so here's all the stuff we're gonna work through for scoring. Your scoring order stuff is actually at the bottom right part, corner of your card. So you have these attribute goals. So let's see if we met them all. The attribute goals are, did I meet these numbers here? So for strength, I have 6, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. So we are good to go on strength. That's 2 points. For dexterity, we actually did manage to get 3 sixes in here for an 18. So that was awesome. For constitution, we actually have 12, but with the +2 modifier, it becomes 14. So we got those 2 points. Our intelligence did cross the 14 line. It is 14 plus, so that is all that we need. Wisdom did not, but we have something else for that, so we don't get that point. But remember, we bought the foolish card that we'll talk about in a second, so we'll get other points. And then for charisma, we just squeaked by. So that's gonna be 2, 4, 6, 8, 9, 11 victory points off of our attribute goals. Next, we're gonna be looking at our class color dice. Rogue is a black class, so I get 1 extra point for every single black die on my board. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So 11 plus 5 is 16. We are at 16 points right now. For my alignment card, we did get all 3 of our victory points. We got that moved over. So that's 19 points that we're at right now. For the backstory card, let's see if we pulled it off. Green, red, blue, purple, black, white. We absolutely did. We successfully fulfilled our backstory of Brawler, which is gonna get us another 6 points. If I'd only gotten 4 or 5 of those dice, that would have put us at 3, but we got them all, so we get 6. So that puts us at 25 points. Now let's have a look at our armor cards. So let's see, we have our leather greaves, our leather pauldron, our leather gloves, and our leather boots. The whole set together is worth 8 points, plus 1 for being worn by a black class. So I get a total of 9 points for this armor. So 25 plus 9 is 34. Now let's look at our trait cards. So we know that for foolish, I get 2 points for having a wisdom score under 8. So that puts me at 36. And then cunning, you get 1 victory point for each skill card that you have. And I have 2, 37, 38. So let's see what that means for us in terms of our scoring. Oh, wow. So this almost never happens to me. Here is the scoring scale for role players, so you can get a sense of how you did. So we got a 38, that puts us at true hero. Usually I can hit clan leader pretty regularly, but it's actually hard for me to get over the threshold and hit true hero. This is a very lucky game and I'm glad y'all got to see it. NPC is of course what happens if things go really wrong. That might've happened in my first game. I don't exactly remember. Maybe I suppressed the memory, but obviously we've gotten a lot better. So you can actually, it's not just beat your own score. It's the score ranges tell you roughly how well you did in the game. So that was Role Player. I hope that you enjoyed it. I certainly do. And keep an eye out for a video on the Monsters and Minions expansion, which is an expansion that I find really enriches this game. So I hope you enjoyed, and happy gaming.